Hello everyone and welcome to Use Your Spanish. Bienvenidos a Use Your Spanish, the place where you can learn the Spanish that you really need. My name is Salo and in today's video we are going to continue with our series of Español en Contexto. This is our episode number 19 and today's topic is Christmas and the holiday season, la temporada navideña. Remember that in this series of videos, Miguel, our Spanish friend, shares with us some of his everyday life stories. This video is divided into three main parts. In the first part, you are going to listen to Miguel's story at a low speed. Then in the second part, I will explain to you some of the most advanced vocabulary and expressions that he used in his story. And then in the last part of this video, you will listen to the story again, but at a normal speed. So, if you are ready, then let's get started. Listen carefully to Miguel's story at a low speed.
Llegan las fiestas de fin de año, y con ellas los regalos, la comida deliciosa y las reuniones con familiares y amigos. Sin duda, es la temporada más alegre del año, al menos a mí me lo parece. Me encanta la Navidad y no solo por los regalos y el ambiente festivo en familia, sino por lo que representa. Además, es la oportunidad perfecta para mostrar nuestro lado más humano y compasivo. Una de las cosas que más me gusta son los villancicos. Esas canciones me llevan atrás en el tiempo y revivo momentos maravillosos de mi infancia. Otra cosa que me encanta son las luces de colores que brillan de noche por todas partes. La gente es muy creativa con sus decoraciones y un simple paseo por las calles o los parques se convierte en una experiencia casi mágica. También me gusta ver a los niños tan emocionados por los regalos que Papá Noel les traerá. Me recuerda lo feliz que yo era en mi niñez. No podía dormir en Nochebuena pensando en los hermosos juguetes que encontraría al día siguiente bajo el árbol de Navidad. Aunque siendo honesto, me emocionaba más por la visita de los Reyes Magos, pues en España son ellos los que realmente traen regalos para los niños. Es una pena que ahora que soy adulto, esa emoción intensa haya desaparecido. La verdad es que ni siquiera decoro mi casa para la Navidad. Para mí no tiene sentido decorar la casa cuando vives solo. No se disfruta y representa mucho trabajo sacar las cosas para después de un par de semanas tener que volver a guardarlas. Por eso, durante estas fiestas, me pego como una lapa a mis hermanos o a mis amigos, quienes están casados y tienen hijos, y les echo una mano instalando el Belén, armando el árbol y poniendo las luces por toda la casa. Allí, junto a ellos y sus hijos, vuelvo a ser niño y vuelvo a disfrutar de la magia de la Navidad.
Okay, I hope that you were able to follow the story. I hope that you were able to understand most of the words that Miguel used in his story. If you didn't understand everything, don't worry, because now in the second part of this video, I am going to explain to you some of the most advanced expressions and vocabulary that Miguel used in the story. So let's go for it. Before I move on to the expressions and the most advanced vocabulary, I would like to give you a small list of keywords that, although they don't need further explanation, it would be useful for you to know their meanings so that you can fully understand the story. The first word is regalos, which means gifts. Then the word familiares, which means relatives. The next word is temporada, which means season. Then paseo. Un paseo is a stroll. When you say I go for a walk, we say voy a dar un paseo. Next word, juguetes. The word juguetes means toys. Then we have the verb disfrutar, which means to enjoy. Next one is the verb armar, which means to assemble. The next one is the word casado for masculine, or casada for feminine, which means married. The next one is the verb brillar, which means to shine. Next one is the verb decorar. It sounds very similar to the one in English, which is decorate. The next one is revivir. Revivir means to relive something, to live something one more time. And finally, we have the verb guardar, which means to save. Now let's move on to some more advanced vocabulary or expressions that Miguel used in the story. The first thing that I want to explain to you is las fiestas de fin de año. Why do I want to explain this to you? Of course, this means end of year festivities. I want to explain this to you because in Spanish, we differentiate between the singular and the plural of the word fiestas. When we use this word in the singular, it usually means a party. For example, una fiesta de cumpleaños, a birthday party, okay? But when we use it in the plural, when we say fiestas in general, we refer mainly to a big celebration, some holidays, festivals, festivities. For example, in this case, las fiestas de fin de año, it is not talking about a party specifically, it's talking about festivities, like the celebration of the end of the year. Now, do you know what are the two most important festivities that we celebrate by the end of the year? The first one is la Navidad, Christmas. We celebrate Christmas during the end of the year. And then we have el Año Nuevo, which is the new year. The main celebration for Christmas on the 24th of December is called Christmas Eve, and in Spanish we can call it in two different ways. Sometimes we say Nochebuena, or sometimes we say La Víspera de Navidad. When it comes to the celebration of the new year, the main celebration is New Year's Eve, which is on the 31st of December. And in Spanish, we can also call it in two different ways. We can say Nochevieja, or La Víspera de Año Nuevo, okay? So as you can see here, we have two different names for each one of the two main celebrations of the end of the year. Let's move on. Miguel used the expression, al menos a mí me lo parece. Al menos a mí me lo parece. Okay, I will explain this expression to you. But before, I would like to point out that this is similar to the expression a mí me parece que, okay? So we have to differentiate between these two expressions. The first one, a mí me parece que, means I think, or it seems to me that. So you use this expression before you give your opinion about something. For example, me parece que eres una buena persona. Me parece que eres una buena persona. I think you are a good person. Or it seems to me that you are a good person. Another example. Me parece que tus padres nunca están de acuerdo contigo. Me parece que tus padres nunca están de acuerdo contigo. It seems to me that your parents never agree with you. Or I think that your parents never agree with you. So you use this expression at the beginning. Now, the other expression, the expression that Miguel used in the story, is expression that usually we use after we give our opinion, at the end of the sentence. The equivalent in English is, at least I think so, or at least it seems like that to me. Let me give you some examples. Fumar es un hábito estúpido, al menos a mí me lo parece. Fumar es un hábito estúpido, al menos a mí me lo parece. Smoking is a stupid habit, at least I think so, or at least it seems like that to me. Another example. El español es un idioma muy bello, al menos a mí me lo parece. El español es un idioma muy bello, al menos a mí me lo parece. Spanish is a beautiful language, at least I think so, or at least it seems like that to me. Let's continue. Since the topic that we are talking about in this video is the end of year festivities in general, but mainly Christmas, I wanted to show you some words, some vocabulary that is very common during this season. Can you name all the objects and all the elements in this picture? Because all of them are related to Christmas. Let's start with el árbol de Navidad, el árbol de Navidad. This tree, the Christmas tree, is characterized because we use some ornaments. Those ornaments in Spanish are called adornos, adornos. The most common adornos in the Christmas tree are la estrella, los lazos, and las bolas, So just in case you were wondering about this basic vocabulary, you know now how we call them. Now, what about this element? It's very common to find these objects in many houses during Christmas time. The name in Spain for this element is el Belén, but in Latin America, especially in my country, in Colombia, we call it el pesebre. So, el Belén refers to the place where Jesus was born, right? You know the story. And el pesebre refers to the place in which traditionally Jesus is placed, which is full of hay, the food for the cows, the food for the cattle. Now, un Belén or un pesebre is composed by three main elements. Of course, there can be many, many other objects or many other elements, but mainly it is composed by three main parts. The first part, of course, is la Virgen María, San José y el Niño Jesús, or el Niño Dios. Okay, so the Virgin Mary, Saint Joseph, and baby Jesus. The second part is los Reyes Magos, the three wise men. And finally, los pastores, the shepherds. So, now you know the name of these elements, which are also very, very common during Christmas time. Okay, this is also very famous. It's actually one of the most common things that you will see during the Christmas season. Of course, we are talking about Papá Noel, Santa Claus, okay? In Spanish, some people call it San Nicolás, some people call it Santa Claus, Santa Claus, etc. It receives many names, but the most common name is Papá Noel. Papá Noel is always featured along with some renos, reindeer. And he's always driving his trineo in order to deliver his regalos for the kids, regalos para los niños, okay? What about these two basic things for Christmas? The Christmas lights, which are very colorful. In Spanish, we call them lucecitas or luces de Navidad or luces navideñas. What about the music that we hear during Christmas, the Christmas carols? Well, we call them villancicos. Okay, so, and finally, we have this other element, very common character during Christmas time, especially in those countries in which you have snow, you have those very cold winters, not like in my country, in Colombia, of course. So, how do you call this in Spanish? You call it a muñeco de nieve, un muñeco de nieve, a snowman. Looking at this picture, we can also name other common things that we usually use in winter or especially in Christmas time. For example, el gorro navideño, or simply el gorro. And of course, la bufanda, the scarf. Okay, now you know the name of all these important and common elements for the Christmas season in Spanish. Okay, let's move on, but before we continue with the rest of the video, I would like to remind you to subscribe to my channel so that you don't miss any of my new videos. Remember that I upload a new video every week and that I have different series of videos for different levels of students learning Spanish. So if you don't want to miss any of my new videos, make sure you hit that subscribe button and that you activate the notification bell so that you receive a notification every single time I upload new content. Also, remember that you can follow me on my social networks on Facebook and Instagram, and that you can visit my website www.useyourspanish.com, where you will find all my content, all my videos organized by categories, as well as additional materials that will help you to keep improving your Spanish every day. And that's it. So now let's continue with the rest of the video. Miguel used the words infancia and niñez. The meaning of these two words is childhood. Let me give you some examples with these words. No recuerdo muchas cosas de mi infancia. No recuerdo muchas cosas de mi infancia. I don't remember many things of my childhood. Another example. Mi padre sufrió mucho durante su niñez. Mi padre sufrió mucho durante su niñez. My father suffered a lot during his childhood. Next one. Miguel used the expression es una pena, es una pena. This expression means it is a pity or it is a shame. Let me give you some examples. Es una pena que no podamos reunirnos como antes. Es una pena que no podamos reunirnos como antes. It is a pity or it is a shame that we cannot get together like before. Another example. La pandemia arruinó la Navidad. Es una pena. La pandemia arruinó la Navidad. Es una pena. The pandemic ruined Christmas. It is a shame or it is a pity. Okay, let's continue. Miguel used the expression no tiene sentido. No tiene sentido. This expression means it doesn't make sense. Let me give you some examples. Lo que me estás contando no tiene sentido. Lo que me estás contando no tiene sentido. What you are telling me doesn't make any sense. Another example. Usar la mascarilla sin cubrirse la nariz no tiene sentido. Usar la mascarilla sin cubrirse la nariz no tiene sentido. Using the face mask without covering your nose doesn't make any sense. Next one. Miguel used the expression volver a. Volver a. Okay, this is very common. Maybe you already know how to use this, but maybe not. So, the meaning of this expression is to go back to, or to do something again. Okay, let me give you some examples. Quiero volver a mi pueblo. Quiero volver a mi pueblo. I want to go back to my hometown. Another example. Mañana volveré a hablar con mi jefe. Mañana volveré a hablar con mi jefe. Tomorrow, I will talk again with my boss. Meaning that you already talked to your boss, but tomorrow you will do it again. And another example. Anoche volví a soñar que podía volar. Anoche volví a soñar que podía volar. Last night, I dreamed again that I could fly. Meaning that you already had that dream before and that last night, you had that dream one more time. Let's continue. Miguel used the expression pegarse como una lapa. Pegarse como una lapa. This is an expression that is mainly used in Spain, but it is common. It is common to hear this expression. The equivalents to this expression in English are to latch onto someone or to cling to someone like a leech. The literal meaning of this expression in Spanish is that you get stuck to someone like a limpet. Those mollusks that live always stuck to the rocks by the sea. So this expression is used to give the idea that you want to be so close to someone that you don't want to separate from that person. Okay, let me give you some examples. Ella se pega a su novio como una lapa. Ella se pega a su novio como una lapa. So it means that she is so clingy with her boyfriend, okay? So she clings to her boyfriend like a leech. Another example. ese niño se pega a su madre como una lapa. Ese niño se pega a su madre como una lapa. That boy or that kid clinges to his mother like a leech. So he doesn't want to separate from his mother. And now the last expression that I want to explain to you. Echar una mano. Echar una mano. This expression means to lend someone a hand or to give someone a hand, meaning that you are helping someone to do something. Let me give you some examples. ¿Podrías echarme una mano con el coche? ¿Podrías echarme una mano con el coche? Could you give me a hand with my car? Another example. Mañana te echo una mano en el jardín. Mañana te echo una mano en el jardín. You can also say, mañana te echo una mano con el jardín. Okay? So, it means, tomorrow I will give you a hand in the garden. Tomorrow I will help you in the garden. Okay, so those were all the words and expressions that I wanted to explain to you. Now, in the third part of this video, you are going to listen to the story at a normal speed. You can test your comprehension skills to see if you can follow the story now that you know the meaning of all the words and expressions that Miguel used. So, if you want, you can close your eyes and listen carefully to the story.
Llegan las fiestas de fin de año y con ellas los regalos, la comida deliciosa y las reuniones con familiares y amigos. Sin duda, es la temporada más alegre del año, al menos a mí me lo parece. Me encanta la Navidad, y no solo por los regalos y el ambiente festivo en familia, sino por lo que representa. Además, es la oportunidad perfecta para mostrar nuestro lado más humano y compasivo. Una de las cosas que más me gusta son los villancicos. Esas canciones me llevan atrás en el tiempo y revivo momentos maravillosos de mi infancia. Otra cosa que me encanta son las luces de colores que brillan de noche por todas partes. La gente es muy creativa con sus decoraciones y un simple paseo por las calles o los parques se convierte en una experiencia casi mágica. También me gusta ver a los niños tan emocionados por los regalos que Papá Noel les traerá. Me recuerda lo feliz que yo era en mi niñez. No podía dormir en Nochebuena pensando en los hermosos juguetes que encontraría al día siguiente bajo el árbol de Navidad. Aunque siendo honesto, me emocionaba más por la visita de los Reyes Magos, pues en España son ellos los que realmente traen regalos para los niños. Es una pena que ahora que soy adulto, esa emoción intensa haya desaparecido. La verdad es que ni siquiera decoro mi casa para la Navidad. Para mí, no tiene sentido decorar la casa cuando vive solo. No se disfruta y representa mucho trabajo sacar las cosas para después de un par de semanas tener que volver a guardarlas. Por eso, durante estas fiestas, me pego como una lapa a mis hermanos o a mis amigos, quienes están casados y tienen hijos, y les echo una mano instalando el Belén, armando el árbol y poniendo las luces por toda la casa. Allí, junto a ellos y sus hijos, vuelvo a ser niño y vuelvo a disfrutar de la magia de la Navidad.
And that's all for this video. I hope that you were able to learn new vocabulary, new expressions, new words, and especially that you were able to improve your listening skills by watching this video. So if you did, if you enjoyed this video, don't forget to leave your comments down below. Don't forget to give me a like and subscribe to my channel. Also, remember that you can follow me on Facebook and Instagram and visit my website www.useyourspanish.com. Once again, thank you very much for watching this video and I'll see you in the next lesson. Muchas gracias por ver este video y nos vemos en una próxima lección. Hasta pronto.